Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? Did he give you a royal escort right out of his domain? Well, if so, I want to hear about it. And so does everyone else out there. So what are you waiting for? Sit down at the computer and type me up an email. And don't leave any details out. We want to hear them all. You can email me directly at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hey there, everyone. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Well, I have to say, it's another clear and beautiful night here in the greater Miami Valley of Ohio. The weather is throwing summer one humdinger of a goodbye party. We've had beautiful warm days and crisp, cool evenings under clear, starry skies. That's just perfect for our journey into Sasquatch Valley. Now, tonight we're going to start on the west coast of the United States, up in Northern California. Then we're going straight across over 2,000 miles to get to the east coast of the United States, right into the mountains of Virginia. Are you ready? Me too. Grab some extra snackage. We're going to need it. Let's go. I listen to many channels on YouTube about Bigfoot. The one thing that I keep noticing is the level of crazy keeps growing with every story I hear. And I have to wonder, are they just that? Stories? I do have a story to tell. The crazy level is very low on it, but it is true. The crazy is so low that I don't know if you'll read it on your channel. But here goes. I was with my husband and two other couples. We were camped at the Moore Creek campground along the McLeod River in the Shasta Trinity Forest. We did different things almost every day that we were there. This was the last day we were there. We planned to leave in the morning. We were running low on energy, all of us, by this time. All three of us couples had Jeeps. Someone had told us there was a great view from the fire tower up on some mountain near where we were. I don't remember the mountain's name, I'm sorry. So we decide to go up in our Jeeps. We had been told the last part of the way up that we would have to creep along on the road because it was so rough and steep. We were also told you cannot drive all the way to the top, but we were going to try anyway. What's the fun in having a Jeep if you can't go where other people can't, right? So we go up this forest road, follow the directions, make our turns, and after a while we start that rough climb we had been told about. We are going along, slow, and creeping carefully. Me and my husband were in the front Jeep. Then our friends Josh and Diane were in the second Jeep, and behind them were Clay and Tina. It was a warm and sunny day, and our Jeeps were completely open. The road was closed in on both sides with firs, pines, and all kinds of trees. I think all of us had sunglasses on. I know me and my husband did, but they weren't so dark that we couldn't see well. At one point, we drove out of the heavy forest part of the woods into a semi-cleared area along a slope with some grassy area and a few trees. But mostly, we were shocked because we could see probably 1,000 feet ahead along the trail road as it curved around the slope. My husband suddenly came to a complete stop. Everyone behind us did as well. I saw my husband pointing to the left side up the slope. There were some dead-looking trees that were still standing over there. They were a gray and white color. But coming right down between them was a very visible brown animal of some kind. My husband said that he put the animal about 75 to 80 yards away from us. Now, we only saw it because of the way the trail road was curving. We all had one-mile walkie-talkies in the Jeeps to communicate. I suddenly heard Clay asking what the heck the holdup was up there. My husband picked up our walkie-talkie and told him quietly to stand up and take a look to the left about 75 yards. Now, Clay had binoculars. My husband also said he wasn't sure what we were looking at, and could Clay please use the binoculars? We watched this animal as it walked down and crossed the trail road. The right side, going down, was an incline that I was sure could not easily be navigated by a human. Now, Clay told us on the walkie that it was either a hoaxer or it was a real Bigfoot up there. We laughed nervously at first, but then Clay said he was not joking. As he's saying that, I didn't realize it, but he had started to walk along the jeeps, and he's suddenly standing by my husband's side of the jeep, and he hands him the binoculars. By now, Josh and Danielle behind us are standing up in their jeep. I could hear them talking, but I couldn't understand what they were saying. My husband then stood up in the jeep and took the binoculars from Clay. He looked through them. Well, he said something that I won't repeat here. We all watched and took turns looking through the binoculars as this Bigfoot slowly came down, walked across the trail road, and went on down the mountain. And it knew that we were there. It stopped about 20 feet back from the road trail, and it looked down our way. My husband had the binoculars at that point, and later he told me it looked dead right at us. He said it waited for 1 or 2 seconds to see, he thought, if we were going to move or what to do before it decided to move on. We watched it for about 2 minutes until we could no longer see it. The animal that I saw when I had the binoculars was at least 7 feet tall. It had very wide shoulders, but a very narrowed waist. The arms were long and muscular, and the torso, I noticed, was half of its total body height. That is to say, the legs and the torso were equal length to make up the whole height. And I noticed the knees on the legs were lower on its leg than a human's knees would be. The arms hung down to mid-thigh. I also noticed, while this thing was going down the mountain, it kept an unnatural, upright position, as if it was walking with ankles bent backwards. It was, and still is, the strangest and most perplexing thing that I have seen in my life. None of us felt like going up to the tower after that. We thought we'd seen the most interesting thing that could be seen on the mountain. We got ourselves turned around, and we left and went back to the river campsite. We have talked about it, and we all mostly agree on the things that we saw and the details. We disagree, though, about one thing that should have been the most visible and the easiest thing to agree on. That is its color. I think that it was a very reddish-brown color, more red than brown. A couple others in the group believe that it was a very dark, almost black color. Danielle, though, insists it was a basic, light brown color, no red. So, no level of crazy here. We saw it, and then we all moved on, us and it. It didn't do any crazy things like try to reach out to us, try to communicate, try to talk to us. It didn't bring out some baby it wanted us to feed. It didn't keep us safe and dry for days, and it didn't fight some other Bigfoot just for our amusement. There was no level of crazy that I hear in a lot of the stories, even on your channel. Now, I don't know if you will use it because there is no level of real crazy, and I guess I would understand if you don't. I know, it's just all about the clickbait headlines for you, and this isn't much of that, is it? Signed, Carla. Hello, Nance and Sasquad. Before I tell you my story, I will tell you a bit of myself to give you some context. I am 61 years old, but I am in excellent health. At my last yearly physical, my doctor, who is 2 years younger than me, told me, literally, that I was so healthy it made him sick. He actually used those words, and then he chuckled. I am on no medications, and I spend much of my time roaming woodlands and forests in search of different herbs. Years ago, I attended Dominion College, and over the course of a few years, I earned a Master Herbalist's degree. I like to go into the forest to identify and locate different herbs that grow wild. Now, for the record, I do not take or harvest any wild herbs. I have only ever taken a cutting or a rooted specimen with permission on private land. I always have respect and leave the wild population of any plant growing that I find as intact as possible. As a side note, I tend to go alone on these identifying trips ever since I once took another young, aspiring herbalist with me that I'd recently met on a particular trip. I returned to many of the areas that we had walked where I had pointed out different herbs growing, only to find that many of those wild populations had been completely dug up and decimated. I confronted the other person, and they admitted that they had dug most of it up. They were selling it online. That was the last time I took anyone with me on an identifying mission. On this day, I was in an area that I had traversed and scouted many times before. I liked to look at how the different plants and herbs are doing from season to season. This was in the George Washington and Jefferson National Forest here in Virginia. I live nearby, so it's an easy day trip for me. That's as close as I will give on the location, because some of the area, if I were to describe it, is quite unusual, and with some diligence, someone may find it. I was making my way to an area that I knew to be covered in wild ginseng. As far as I was aware, no one had been harvesting this patch. I was checking on it as legal ginseng harvesting started on September 1st. There are places where you can and cannot harvest wild ginseng. This was not one of the allowed places to harvest, but I find that people often choose to ignore what's legal and what isn't when it comes to harvesting. I knew on the way to the ginseng patch that there were a few areas along the way with wild dill and another with some wild fennel. But I apparently am not the only one to know where those patches are. I got within eyesight of a patch of wild fennel, and I stopped in my tracks because I saw what I took to be a large black bear sitting on its rump with its back partially turned to me. I could not see its face, but I saw it reach out and pull a fennel plant out of the ground, lift it, pull the flowers off, and then I assume it put it to its face. But what I saw reach out wasn't a bear paw. I stood where I was, hardly breathing. I was about 40 or 50 feet away from it. It was too close if I should try to outrun it, if it noticed me, whatever it was. I hoped it would do as most bears that I've ever encountered do, and that is they will keep following the path of whatever it was eating. In this case, the yellow fennel flowers that ran for another 20 or 30 feet in the other direction. I knew that fennel is good for digestive issues and a host of other issues, but I was not aware of bears eating it. And when I thought about that, I told myself, "You didn't see a bear's paw, though, did you?" I mentioned that I do a lot of woodland and forest journeys, so I'm not unaware of the flora and fauna that they contain. I'm actually very well acquainted with them, and I can identify almost anything I encounter. But I did not know what I was looking at, which is another reason I stood still and quiet. I wanted to know what it was. It pivoted on its rump and slightly turned in order to reach for more fennel. This gave a clear side view to me. The sloping forehead was now very easy to see because there was sun coming from trees to light up the top of the head, but the side of the face itself was still in shadows most of the time. For about half a second, tree limbs above moved with the breeze, and the sun hit its face directly. But not long enough for me to really see much, except that the face seemed to have a different texture than the fur that I could see covering it. But I'm not so confident to say that it was leathery, or any other descriptive terms that I've heard. I'm only confident in saying there was a noticeable difference in the texture that I saw, but I am not confident as to what the texture was. It pulled more fennel flower stems and put them up to its mouth and lips, stripping the flowers off the stems. It wasn't eating the woody stems, I noticed, just the flowers with the seeds. After a few more clumps of fennel flowers, it lay down on its side. I watched as it fidgeted like it was uncomfortable. I thought I heard a grunt or a small groan, Amusingly, it sounded to me the way a kid with a stomachache sounds when it's griping at you and it wants to stay home from school. I think the first few minutes of watching it, I still almost thought that it was something else, something or anything other than what it actually was. But I recognized that it was a Sasquatch, while at the same time keeping my distance and trying to think that maybe it was something else. And what that something else was that I was trying to convince myself that I saw, I don't know. But I wasn't going yet with the thought that it was really a Sasquatch, totally 100%. But the point came when I saw it laying on its side, bending its knees upwards like a human would while laying on its side, and then I saw the elbow of the arm going in a motion back and forth along the side that suggested to me it was rubbing its midsection. And I saw exactly where the good Lord split that animal, and it was very defined. That is when I had to admit I knew what I was looking at. That was a Sasquatch. It was a cold-brained moment for me. I mean, I actually felt icy up in my head when I realized it. Getting away from that area was now my only thought. This was a very large creature that I knew absolutely nothing about. I was unarmed other than some bear spray, and I was a good 45-minute hike or more from the nearest place that I was likely to find other humans for help. I started very quietly, stepping backwards, lightly, looking back with each step, then looking back forward to see, had it heard me. Every noise seemed magnified 1,000 times over. I tried to reason with myself and say, it hadn't heard me walking up, so it wasn't probably going to hear me leaving. But I guess the difference was, when I was walking up on it, it was actively over there moving around, pulling plants up and chewing. But now it was laying there quiet, its head near to the ground. Of course, I made a misstep. I heard a crack, something I stepped on, and it heard it too. I froze in terror. My heart was actually racing, and when it suddenly sat up quickly, it turned its upper body to look in my direction. And sheer terror and panic came over me when I knew it saw me. When it stood up, I almost died. But instead of coming toward me, which was my biggest fear, it gave me one last look, then started to walk away from my direction. I noticed it was calm and unhurried. I stood there, breathing in shaky breaths as it got smaller and smaller as it walked away from me. I suddenly had no more interest in any herb treasure hunting, as I had called it, and I retreated from the area quickly. I did it without actually running, though. Okay, I think I sprinted and jogged a little bit when I was away from that area. I knew enough to not let it see me run, but I could not stop myself once I was away from the area. I still go herb identifying and sighting, but I will confess that I've never been back to that exact area. I don't mean to be all dramatic about it, but I kind of seize up when I think about going back there. I admit it did not threaten me at all, but it doesn't change my feelings when I think about it. I have watched a lot of videos since that day. I think I've read the entire BFRO website of all encounters, and I've read every book that I can on the subject of Sasquatch. I am confident 100% that this is what I saw that day. Interestingly, I've actually given it more thought as to what I saw, and I'm also certain that it knew to eat that wild fennel to cure some digestive issue that was ailing it. I saw it reach around other growing plants just to get to only the fennel flowers. Of course, it's possible that the Sasquatch only liked the taste of the fennel, which is a licorice anise type of flavor. But by the other actions of it, I think it was self-medicating in a way. I have read many times of different animals in the wild being observed seeking out certain plants in order to self-medicate, or to, say, rid themselves of certain parasites. I think this Sasquatch had some kind of stomach ache or some kind of digestive issue, and it knew what to eat and where to find it. So now when I encounter a previously known area of an herb and I find it decimated, I do wonder, was that the work of a human? Or was there a Sasquatch in need of self-medicating? Signed, Darlene, from Covington, Virginia. Well, thank you, Carla, and thank you, Darlene, for sending your encounters in. Now listen, everyone, when I got Carla's story, I contacted her, and we exchanged a few emails. Carla really does think that many of the stories submitted here and on other channels are outlandish, and she calls them obviously fake. I do understand why she feels that way. And I've said before that there have been some stories submitted to this channel that are so far-fetched, I am not going to record them. But then there are a lot of stories that Carla specifically mentioned as having been on my channel that she thinks they're still too far out there to be believed. So as I told Carla, the thing is, once you enter into the topic of Bigfoot or Sasquatch or really any cryptid, you have entered the realm of what 95% of the people believe to be outlandish, too fantastical, and not believable. It's all just degrees of what is and is not believable, and those degrees vary greatly from person to person. So just remember, once you delve into the topic of cryptids, especially Sasquatch, you've crossed the cryptid Rubicon. There's no going back to levels of believability that the majority of people out there have. After that, it's just a matter of what degree of believability do you personally find for yourself, isn't it? In the end, Carla and I actually came to a lot of agreements, and we found that we're really not so different in our thinking after all. And as for Darlene, I've heard of many animals eating specific plants to help them. I don't know, somehow they do know what works for them. So I think it's entirely reasonable that that Sasquatch was self-medicating. I am of the belief that they are thinking and reasoning beings. I believe they have memories, and they have an instinct that far surpasses our own. I think they have them in the league with many other animals on the planet that also far surpass us. So a little fennel to alleviate an upset stomach or some other ailment? Well, I do find that believable, even if others don't. Well, thanks again to everyone for sending those stories in, and thank you to everyone for listening, tuning in, and sticking with me all the way to the end. Until we do meet up again, I need you to remember something for me. Remember that absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.